tal, amigos? Buenas tardes, buenos días, buenas noches. Mi nombre es Daniel y esta es una nueva clase de español como lengua extranjera. Hello everyone, my name is Daniel and this is a new lesson to learn Spanish as a foreign language. In today's class, we will be talking about the use of two personal pronouns in Spanish, the pronoun tú and the pronoun usted. En la clase de hoy, vamos a aprender cómo utilizar los pronombres personales tú y usted. Now, this is a topic that most of you find actually very easy because it's a matter of just differentiating between the person you're talking to. So this is like a social part of language where you just need to see who is the person you're talking to, like if it's an old person, if it's a respected person. So that is not a problem when you are learning the pronouns tú and usted. However, I'll divide this class into three parts. Number one would be the grammar implications that the usage of these pronouns have when we use tú, when we use usted in different like tenses. Number two, we will also check different like possibilities, different situations where you can use tú or usted. And number three, we will see some example sentences that I hope you find useful when you're talking to people in Spanish. There we go. So the first thing that I want to look at is the use of the word cortesía. Now in Spanish, we use this word to refer to, this is the word for politeness, cortesía. Esta palabra es un sustantivo. This is a noun. This is politeness. We say cortesía. And then here below, I added one adjective. This is an adjective. We say cortés. Cortés is the word for polite, as in when someone is polite, you say es una persona muy cortés. He is a very polite person. However, the word cortés is not like widely used. I guess not a lot of people use it. Actually, people use this word instead. They use educado. Now you will see it and you will like quickly think, oh, okay, this is a word for educated. Well, in a way, but in Spanish, we use the word educado, which is also an adjective. Esta palabra también es un adjetivo. We use this word to refer to someone who is very polite, as in when you say, esa persona es muy educada. So as you can see here, I repeat, we have cortesía, which means politeness, and then we have cortés, and then we have educado. So the two words can work for polite, for being polite. Now in this part of the video, I'll show you several like grammar like implications when you are using tú or usted. The first thing I need you to focus on is that these two words are pronouns. They are personal pronouns and they refer, as personal pronouns, they refer to people. So in this case, we have tú, which is the second personal in the singular. Let's say in the singular part, you say I, that is yo, and then you say you, tú. And also we have usted. Now, this is a tricky thing. The both personal pronouns refer to another person, like you, right? Like you. However, in grammar, let's say in the grammar of Spanish, the word usted, you will always locate it into the third person. So as you can see here, we have yo, tú. And here in this part, you have él, ella, usted. So I said that it's kind of tricky because the word usted refers to a second person, right? However, in this grammar, like in this grammar conjugation, you will always find it into the third person. So in Spanish, we have here, we have él, ella, and usted, which means he, this is the third person for that. This is he, él. Then you have ella, which is she, it's a female. And then you have usted, which is the formal way to address someone, okay? You say usted, okay? So this is a present tense. Now, as I told you, these are some grammar, like this is some sort of grammar explanation where you will find that the use of tú and usted is not only about knowing who you are talking to, like being respectful or being polite or not being polite. This has to do also with how you conjugate the verb. And that is the tricky part because a lot of people sometimes they find it so like easy to just rely on the word usted for everything. They say, I want to be polite, so I will call everyone usted, which is good, it's great. It talks a lot about you being cortés, you being polite. However, you also have to change some grammar parts in your sentences when you're using tú or usted. So here, as you can see here in this portion, we have the present tense with the verb to have. Tenemos aquí las combinaciones del verbo tener con una conjugación. This is a conjugation for conjugation, right? So we have here the verb tener. We say yo tengo. Then you say tú tienes. You have. You. And then usted tiene. So as you can see, this is one first grammar like a trick you have to change. Also in the present tense, you don't add the s in the formal way. So a common mistake that students and Spanish learners make is this one. You say, usted tienes. A lot of times I have heard that mistake, usted tienes, because they say, okay, I want to be polite, so I use usted, but then they forget about the conjugation, okay? So this is one form. Then the second like grammar implication that you can have when you're using tú or usted is the use of the verb gusta, for example, or these type of verbs which I call gustar verbs. These verbs use another pronoun here, okay? This is another pronoun. In another video, if you want, like here you will find small card on the video. You will find a card where you can click and you can go to the class about reflexive pronouns. These are not reflexive pronouns, okay? These are different verbs. So I like to differentiate these two types of verbs, reflexive verbs and liking verbs, I like to call them. Like, there are different verbs in Spanish where you have to use these forms. And again, you have to change accordingly. You have to change the pronoun into the corresponding form, be it tú or be it usted. For example, here you say, te gusta, when you're talking to your friend, when you're talking to someone, you have like some level of confidence with him, with her. So you say, te gusta comer en este restaurante? Do you like to eat in this restaurant? As in, when I'm talking to like some member of my family, someone who I have some like level of confidence. And then you can say also with using usted, you use this pronoun, le gusta. Such as when you ask questions, right? So you can ask these, you can use them as questions. So you can say, te gusta, do you like? Do you, my friend, someone who I already know? And then you can say, le gusta, to someone who you actually don't know, an unknown person, someone who is new in your life, right? Or someone who also you respect, or someone who is older than you. So this is another grammar implication here. And then we have another, this would be imperativo. This would be a topic that for some of you who are basic learners, maybe you will not really grasp the meaning of this imperativo. I'll tell you a little bit about it. Imperativo is a grammar mood in Spanish. What is that? What's a grammar mood? A grammar mood is like a way to show your intention when you are talking. And guess what? Spanish is a language where you have to use a special conjugation, a specific conjugation when you are giving orders, when you are telling somebody to do something. Usually people say, and teachers and books explain this grammar mood as related to orders, like commands. But this is not only about commands. I would define it like this. Imperativo, the imperative mood in English, is when you want somebody to do something. That's the intention of imperativo. So also when you use imperativo in Spanish, you have to have a specific conjugation, such as here, for example. And this becomes really important. I mean, here, the grammar of tú and usted becomes more important, because when you tell somebody to do something, you want to be polite, right? Because you're telling somebody to do it. Like, as when you request something or you want something from somebody else, you usually don't go straight and say it. Like, give it to me, or like move, or like buy this, or go there, or do this, or do that. We usually don't do this. We try to use other words. Now, in English, you can use like other expressions added to your sentence, such as the word please, like the word madame, like the word sir, or maybe you backshift it in the tense, like when you say, would you or could you please, and those things. But in Spanish, we can use it only by changing the verb into the imperative mood, by conjugating it. So here, for example, you can see tú, and when I'm telling, for example, when I'm telling my son, when I'm telling my daughter, someone, you say, come tu comida. eat your food. Okay, finish your, finish it. You say, come. Or also when you, for example, the word for come in Spanish is very common. We say, we can say, ven. This is an irregular imperative. You say, ven, ven, which sounds a little bit buzzy when you say, ven. But it's okay if you know the person already, okay? Tú, like, come, you eat, ten. As when you say, here you go, there you go, here you have it, ten. My friend, okay, I'm talking to my friend, we have confidence, we're friends, so we say, ten, ven, I feel happy, I feel normal, I mean, calling him, tú, right? However, when you tell somebody to do something and this person is older than you, or this person is maybe your boss, or he's in a, like, some sort of higher position than you, so you have to address him as usted. So you say, coma. Usually people say, like, por favor, coma, and sounds great, sounds so polite in Spanish, and people will not be confused, and they will understand, and they will say, oh, ese hombre es muy educado. Great, right? So they will say, this man is so polite, or they will tell you, I like to be with you, me gusta, I like to talk to you, me gusta hablar contigo, porque eres muy educado, which is good in any language. So you have, coma, please, you eat, you sirs, eat, or you, sir, you, madam, eat, something like that. And then you say, tenga, like, here you go, like, old, highly respected person, here you go, tenga. And, of course, like, you please come here, you say, venga, okay, venga. So there you go. These are some grammar tricks that you need to consider when you are using to or when you are using usted. And in the next part, I'll explain a little bit about the degree of politeness that we use and also some like variations in different Spanish dialects. Pues bien, amigos, en esta parte del video voy a explicarles algunas características de cada uno de estos pronombres personales. En esta parte tenemos tú y en esta parte tenemos usted. So, in this part of the video, I'm going to show you some of the most important characteristics of these two personal pronouns. As you can see, here I have tú and here we have usted. Okay? So, the first thing here is the level of politeness or the level of intimacy you have with the other person, with the person who, with the listener, right? Now, I want to explain this. The degrees of politeness vary according to where you come from, right? I have read some articles about it. Depending on your country, depending on your culture, you will have more trouble when you speak a foreign language because of the degree of politeness. Now, I don't want to say that Spanish is the most polite language. I'm not sure because I only speak English and Spanish, but I think that it's one of the most polite languages. People have in great regard how polite people talk. It also depends on where, on your country, because also among the Spanish community, among the Spanish, the Spanish-speaking countries, some are more polite than others. Okay, maybe you can let me know in the comments if in your language you consider your language as a polite language, or maybe you have had some trouble when being polite to people. So you need to consider this when you're learning a language, how polite you can be or how impolite you can be, or what others will consider impolite, what others will consider as cortés or educado. Because if you are not this, if you are not educado, then you are a, my goodness, maleducado. What's a maleducado? Well, maleducado is the word for someone who is impolite. In Spanish, you can say, él es un maleducado. He's a very impolite person. He's rude and he, don't talk to him. Don't talk to him. And that's the worst thing that can happen to you. People not wanting to talk to you. Okay, so here we have usted and tú. So, formality. Usted es más formal. Usted es una palabra más formal. Usted is a more formal word. Whereas tú is an informal word. What is that? Well, formal, it's like more proper, right? You speak properly. You can use it in your trabajo. This is the word for job. Trabajo, in an office environment. En una oficina, en una compañía, o en simplemente en un trabajo. Las personas que trabajan en una escuela frecuentemente dicen usted, okay? I have had some teachers who actually call, the teacher calls the student usted. Wow, because even though they are like in a higher position because they are like the professor, right? They address the students as usted because they want to show they are very polite. So formal, you can use it in the job. However, tú, which is more informal, más informal, this is Spanish, informal or formal, you can use it with friends, amigos, with your friends, amigos, you say, oye tú, right? You say, oye tú, ven acá. Oye tú, ven acá. Necesito tu ayuda. Hey you, my friend, come here, I need your help. So, oye tú. And also you can use it with the family. Now, this is a matter of age also, right? Long time ago, I guess people used to call, you have your parents, your mom, your dad, you used to call them, you used to address them like usted. Not anymore, right? People have become more impolite maybe. So, in general terms, you can call your family, such as your hermano, hermana, tío, tía, primo, sobrino, sobrina, you can call them tú. But maybe your abuelo, your abuelito, or your abuelita, your abuelo or your abuela, your grandparents, sometimes people don't call them tú because they are old. They are what? They are personas mayores. This is a word for elderly, right? This expression for elder people, right? You say personas mayores. So when you're talking to personas mayores, even if they're your grandpa, I guess some people call them also tú. It depends on how respectful you want to be, right? You say personas mayores, elder people. Oiga, abuelo, ¿puede contarme una historia? Oiga, which is the imperative for hey, like listen to me, like oiga, but for usted, right? But if me and my grandpa, we're very close, we're very linked, we have, oye, abuelo, ¿puedes contarme una historia? Hey, grandpa, tell me a story. Tell us a story. We want to know your stories. Personas mayores. Then we also can use it, the personal pronoun tú, you can use it with conocidos, with people you already know, you have already met. Even, for example, in the small stores, like in corner stores, you go there. This is the first time you go there. Of course, you want to be polite. So you say, por favor, señor. Wow, so Spanish. Por favor, señor, puede. Why puede? Because I'm not saying puedes. I'm saying puede. ¿Puede darme un paquete de cigarros? ¿Puede darme? Can you please? Would you be so kind as to give me one pack of cigarettes? Like, you're using usted, puede darme, because it's the first time you go there. Then you go again, then you go again, then you go again, and then you have been visiting that store for so many months. So then it's time to start with tú, I think. So you say, hola, ¿puedes darme un paquete de cigarros? Hola, dame. Hey, you, my friend, you, the shop assistant, I have already met you, so I feel confident enough to call you tú, right? There you go. So, informal, formal, amigos, trabajo, familia, personas mayores. Okay, let me take my straw. So, conocidos, these people you already met, and desconocidos, unknown people, desconocidos. So, if you want to be cortés, if you want to be educado, you can always use usted, but remember the first part of this lesson. You need to use proper grammar with each of them. So in the next part of this video, I'll explain a little bit about the different usage of these tú and usted in some countries, of course in my country as well, and also a little bit about the origin of this word, which is rather strange for some people. Even some Spanish speakers might find this lesson useful. El uso de los pronombres tú y usted a veces es un poco confuso para los que están aprendiendo español. The use of the pronouns tú and usted sometimes can be tricky, can be confusing for those who are studying Spanish in a specific dialect. As you know, Spanish is spoken in so many countries, is the second largest spoken language in the world, and there are a lot of variations from one country to another. So here I'll show you a very specific thing for, especially for those who are learning Spanish from, maybe you're learning Spanish from Spain, some others are learning Spanish from Mexico, some other people that study Spanish I don't know, maybe in Puerto Rico, in Cuba, in Venezuela, who knows? So what is the use of tú and usted in some countries? Well, I'm from Mexico, and in Mexico, the use is the one I just showed you, right? The one I just taught you. This, when it's formal and informal, etc. But guess what? In Colombia, they use an informal form of usted. Yeah, this is the tricky part. A lot of Colombians usually call in a very informal way, they call you usted. So they say, for example, the mom to the father, to the son, they say, pero usted me dijo que iba a hacer su tarea. Usted me lo dijo. They say, you told me you were going to do your homework, but you didn't do it. So they're using usted, but this is a five-year-old guy, and I'm older. I'm the father, so I should be respected. And they use usted, right? They use usted everywhere. And so it's kind of confusing out there. If there are some Colombians who can explain this to us, like which context you use this for. Well, I just wanted to tell you this because sometimes some of you Spanish learners may find this, like you will say, come on, I went to Colombia, I went there, and everywhere they were using usted. Why is that? Well, it's just a dialect, okay? They like to use this. Of course, there are other ways to be polite, to be educado in Spanish. We have the words for señor, we have the words for señora, señorita, and so many other expressions. Of course, the magical words, thank you and please, gracias and por favor. So all those are ways to become educado, to become cortés, okay? To be cortés, to be polite in one language. Well, I hope you find this at least interesting. And now the last thing I want to tell you, where does this word come from? I was doing some research and I found this very interesting thing. The word usted is like a short form of a very old expression. This is an archaism, right? This is an expression that people in the 16th and 15th century used to address to highly respected people. You know, in those days, if you watch Game of Thrones or things like that, you will be familiarized with this way of talking, right? Well, of course, that's like totally like fantasy. But if you like to watch like historical dramas and those things, you will find that sometimes they address people, they address the king, they address the princess and things. They address them as like your majesty, they say. Does it sound familiar? Like, or they say his excellency. So those are like titles. So well, in Spanish, back in those days, this is a history, grammatical thing. They used this word, vuestra merced. Vuestra merced, meaning like, thanks to you, I can do this. Meaning like a way of thanking and at the same time being very polite. It's like saying, okay, like I'm thanking you because thanks to your grace, I can do this. So little by little, through time, this language, this beautiful Spanish language evolved. And it became this part. So people started like, this is an oral thing. So it's actually very hard to track specifically when people started to use usted. Yeah, it would be interesting to know when people started to use usted, right? To track why they use this. But it's almost impossible to track it. However, researchers, scholars have found that it happened like this. From vuestra merced, it became vuesanced, vuasted, vuested, and finally people started to make it shorter. So who knows, maybe one day all those expressions that you also have in English, like gonna, wanna, like, kinda, all those things, who knows, maybe in like a couple hundreds of years we will be using it like this. So this was just a brief note about the history of the word. And well, here you go. Si quieres ser más cortés, si quieres ser más educado, I suggest using this word, usted. And if you want to sound more like cool and more familiar, and you want not to sound like awkward, because also you can sound very awkward if you use them interchangeably, you know, like sometimes Spanish learners say, I'm going to use usted because that way I'm going to sound very polite, right? And they use usted with everyone. So sometimes it sounds awkward because maybe you see your friend who you have been like, you know, like having lunch after office hours with him for so many months and you still call him usted. That sounds so weird. Or maybe you're talking to your students and you say usted. It sounds awkward. So you always need to be changing from usted to tú. So as soon as you see an old person, you say, okay, usted, right? ¿Cómo está, señor? ¿Cómo está usted? ¿Puede darme? Hello, sir. How are you? Can you give me this? Can you give me that? As in when you're buying. And maybe like you switch to tú and you say, hola, amigo, ¿cómo estás? Hola, amigo, ¿cómo estás? Tienes un poco de whatever, like anything you want. So, there you go. These are the informal. This is the informal pronoun. This is the formal pronoun. Now, if you like this lesson, if you find it interesting or something, please comment, like it, and subscribe. Thank you very much for watching it. Hasta luego.